students, in my last video we have studied the introduction part of ecology. We have studied what is the definition of ecology. We have also studied who is the father of ecology, that is Ramdev Mishra is going to be the father of ecology. Together with that we have also studied what are the biotic components and abiotic components. So biotic components and abiotic components, when they are varying or when they are going to be present in different forms with each other, they are going to be forming our biomes. That also we have studied in my last video. So today we are going to be starting how these abiotic factors are affecting the biotic components. So what are biotic? Biotic is nothing but all the living organisms. What are abiotic? Abiotic are going to be the non-living things. They are going to be four important abiotic factors that we are going to be studying, that is temperature, water, light and soil. These are going to be the four important abiotic factors which are going to be affecting the life of the organisms. So remember, here we are going to be studying or dealing with the organisms. What is an organism? Organism is going to be one single individual. You, me, or it can be a dog, it can be a cat, or it can be an elephant, it can be a small bacteria. Right from the pathogen to the parasites, right from the predators to the human beings, all of us are going to be organisms as individuals. So how these abiotic factors are going to be affecting the organisms? We have to see that, or we are going to study that, how these abiotic factors affect the living organism, that is the biotic factors. So let us study with the major abiotic factors. As I told you, four important abiotic factors: temperature, water, light and soil. These are the four important abiotic factors. Let us start with the first one, that is your temperature. So when we are talking about temperature, what is temperature? Temperature is going to be nothing but the degree of hotness or coldness. How hot it is, how cold it is. Maybe it is the climate or maybe the internal environment of our organisms. What is going to be, or how much is going to be the hotness or coldness, we are going to be referring it as the temperature. So how this temperature is affecting the organisms? Consider the temperature now. Temperature is going to be different in different areas of our earth. If we are talking about the equator to the pole, that is the north pole or the south pole, there are going to be variety of regions present. These include the Amazon evergreen forest at the equators, or they include the Rajasthan deserts or the Egyptian deserts, or they include the north pole and the south pole, that is Antarctic regions. Between these regions there are variety of temperature ranges. In the deserts we can see that temperature can be around 50 degrees Celsius into the summer, whereas at the Antarctic region, that is at the poles, they can be around 0 degrees Celsius, or maybe they are going to be minus degrees Celsius. It is going to be very very cold at the Antarctic regions. So there is going to be so much of temperature variations present when we are talking about our earth. Whether it is going to be the colder areas, whether it is the warmer areas, or whether it is the hotter areas, in all these areas we can see the organisms are living. But the organisms who are going to be living into the hotter climates, they cannot survive into the colder climates, and vice versa. For example, camel. Camel is going to be very well adapted to the desert, but this camel cannot survive into the colder areas, or the camel cannot come and they cannot survive in the forest areas. They are going to be adapted specifically to the deserts. So different organisms have modified themselves in a proper way so that they can adjust to these temperatures. So here we can see that there are going to be different type of temperatures, and these temperatures are going to be affecting the kinetics of enzymes. Now what are enzymes? Enzymes are going to be those proteinaceous substances present in our body which are increasing the rate of reaction. our body is going to be made up of metabolism, that is sum total of chemical reactions are taking place in our body. So these chemical reactions are carried forward due to enzymes, and the rate of these enzymes or the speed of these reactions of the enzymes is going to be affected by the temperature. For this best example, you can take of milk getting converted into curd. Suppose you want to convert the milk into curd. You are keeping one bowl of milk and little bit of curd you put and you keep it into the refrigerator. You take the same quantity of milk and curd and you keep it on the room temperature. Which one will get converted into curd, complete curd faster? It is going to be, of course, that which is kept at room temperature. Why? Because conversion of milk into curd is because of an organism, that is a bacteria, that is lactobacilli. So this organism is getting affected due to the temperature. When it is having the room temperature or a moderate temperature, it is able to do the metabolic properties faster. The kinetics of the enzyme is faster at the room temperature. But when you are talking about in the refrigerator, the same rate is slower and hence the process is slower. This is the reason why the fridge is used for storing of the foods. Because of the low temperature, the metabolic rates are getting decreased, the rotting of the substances is getting decreased. Because the rate of the kinetics of the enzyme, which is going to be responsible for that rotting, is going to be slower. So in this manner, we are able to see that the kinetics of the enzyme is getting affected with the temperature, and hence it is going to be an important abiotic factor. Together with that, we can see this temperature also affects the BMR, that is nothing but basal metabolic rate. In total, whatever metabolic processes are taking place in our body are going to be somewhere affected due to the temperature. You can take our own example. We can see that when it is summer season, we feel thirsty very fast, or we drink more of water. But in the winter season, we are drinking less water, or we are eating less food in the winter season when compared to summer season. Why is that? Because it is getting affected due to the temperature. Our body is changing due to the temperature. Then also the other physiological actions, any other physiological actions are going to also be affected due to temperature. So we can see these are going to be important factors which are going to be making the temperature an important abiotic factor. Here we can see temperature not only affects the kinetics, that is the rate of the enzyme, but also it is changing the basal metabolic rate and other physiological actions. Based upon this, we can see that there are going to be two types of organisms. One, which are able to withstand, or which are going to be able to survive into this changing temperature. For example, suppose the human beings are there, human beings are going to be able to survive in all the three seasons, or suppose we are going into a colder climate. Suppose I am going to be going from here to the Himalayas, I will be alive, I won't be dying. Suppose I am going to go to Rajasthan desert for some time, so there I won't get dissolved or not, I am going to die over there. I am able to withstand little bit climatic conditions. So here, those organisms who can withstand the change in the temperature are going to be grouped into one class. But the other organisms are there. For example, you can take a fish. Fish stays in water. Suppose you are having an aquarium. In an aquarium, if the water temperature rises, the fish will die. Suppose we are going to be lowering the temperature, also the fish will die. The temperature of the fish has to be maintained, because their body is not able to maintain that temperature. So some organisms are able to survive different ranges of temperature, while the others are not able to withstand that. So based upon that, we are having two types of organisms, urethermal and stenothermal. Urethermal organisms are those which can tolerate wide range of temperature. Wide range of temperature means what? Here, these organisms which are able to survive in different climatic conditions, that is different temperature ranges, they are able to survive. They are known as the urethermal organisms. And on the other hand, stenothermal are those organisms suppose little bit of temperature are rising or cooling, they are going to be dying. So here those organisms who cannot withstand, or those who can withstand only a small or a narrow range of temperature, they are going to be called as the xenothermal organisms. So based upon the temperature as an abiotic factor, we are having two types of organisms, eurythermal and xenothermal. Eurythermal, they can withstand the change in the temperature or broad range, whereas xenothermal are going to be those which cannot withstand the change in the temperature, or which are surviving only a narrow range of temperature changes, are known as the xenothermal organism. So this is going to be temperature as an abiotic factor. So coming to the second abiotic factor is going to be the water. Now what is this water? So water is going to be the most important abiotic factor for the life, that is for the organisms. In fact, it is said that the life on earth first originated in the water. That is, the new organisms that were formed when the earth was formed is going to be in the water. So water is going to be a very, very important abiotic factor which is affecting the life of the organism. So here we can see that this water is not only going to be affecting the productivity and distribution of the plants, but we can see it is also playing a major role for the type of organisms that are present, that is the type of animals also are going to be different depending upon the type of water. There are different types of waters present based upon which the different type of plants and different type of animals are going to be present. So which are going to be the different type of waters? So these waters are going to be different only because of their salinity. So what is salinity? Salinity is nothing but the amount of salt that is present in the water is going to be called as the salinity. So this salt that is going to be present in the water is going to be different in the different type of waters. For example, if you are taking your fresh water or the inland waters, like for example you can take your river, lake or your borewells or your wells, here you can see that the fresh water are going to be having around 5% of the salt that are dissolved. When we are talking about the sea waters are going to be having more of the salt content, the sea and the ocean waters. They are going to be having around 30 to 35% of the salt dissolved in it. So based upon how much of salt is going to be present in the water, different types of waters are going to be present. So inland waters are having around 5% of the salt, and the sea waters and the ocean waters are going to be having around 30 to 35% of the salt dissolved in it. Then what is the third one? Third one are going to be the hypersaline lagoons. On our earth, apart from the fresh water and the sea water and ocean water, we are having more saltier waters also. They are known as the hypersaline lagoons, in which we are having around 100% of salt. Complete salt is present. In fact, there is going to be no water. You can say it is going to be dissolved salt only. Where are these type of hypersaline lagoons present? One example is going to be your Dead Sea. You must all have heard about the Dead Sea. Now when we are talking about this Dead Sea is not actually a sea, but it is a large lake. Why it is known as a dead? It is known as dead because it is a hypersaline lagoon. And because of this 100% salt present over there, no organism is able to survive over there. 99% of nine organisms are not able to survive in this type of 100% hypersaline lagoon. In fact, suppose a heavy body like us, like the human bodies, are also if they are going into this hypersaline lagoon, we are floating on that water. We are not able to drown in that water or go down in the water, because the density of these waters is going to be more than our body because of the salt present in them. And hence we are not drowning in these waters, so no organisms are able to survive over them. Because of which they are going to be called as the hypersaline liquids. But apart from this fact, in our nature, we are having such organisms who are able to survive even in this hypersaline liquids. Which are they? Example, bacteria. One best example of these organisms is the bacteria. Bacteria is going to be one such organism who is able to survive into a wide range of temperature or water or the even pH ranges. It is a very strong organism, you can say. It is designed itself in such a way that it is able to survive in many harshful or dreadful conditions also. So there are going to be some organisms who are able to survive into only fresh water. Like for example, fish. Suppose you are taking a freshwater fish and putting it into the salt water, it is not able to survive. Suppose you take a saltwater fish and put it into the fresh water, it is not able to survive. But the bacteria are able to survive. So based upon that, there are two types of organisms, urehaline and stenohaline. What is urehaline organisms? Urehaline organisms are those organisms which can tolerate wide range of salinities. Can tolerate wide range of salinities means these different type of waters they are able to tolerate. Example I gave you just now, bacteria. Apart from bacteria, you can take even us human beings. Human beings, suppose you are going and swimming into the fresh water, you are not dying. Suppose you are going for swim into the sea water, your body is able to survive. That we are known as here, to some extent even we are urehaline organisms. Stenohaline, organisms which can tolerate only narrow range of salinity, only a narrow range. Example, fish. Now this fish is not able to survive in different types of waters. Why? A question can be asked. Why a freshwater fish does not survive in sea water and vice versa? Why is that it is not able to survive? The answer here is due to the osmotic problems it will face. Osmotic problems. What is osmosis? We have studied in last year. Osmosis is nothing but the movement of the water molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration through the semi-permeable membrane. So whenever there is going to be higher concentration present, if we are having a semi-permeable membrane, the water molecules will start passing through it. So fish is going to be such type of organism whose skin is permeable to water, because fish is living in water and it is exchanging many minerals with the water. It is taking oxygen from the water through its skin also. So hence, the skin is going to be permeable to water molecules. The skin is coming inside the body of the water, is going to be coming inside the body of the fish and going outside. So it is permeable. So suppose we are putting a freshwater fish into a sea water, what will happen? Inside the body of a freshwater fish, fresh water is present, that is, salt is going to be less. If we are putting it into the sea water, the salt is going to be more. So what will happen? Movement of the water molecules will start, so that the equilibrium is taking place. Because of which, the fish can burst or it can shrink. And hence we can see, due to these osmotic problems, a freshwater fish cannot survive in the seawater and a seawater fish cannot survive in the freshwater. So they are going to be stenohaline. They are not able to survive. They are not able to tolerate the heavy ranges or the wide ranges. They are able to survive only narrow range of salinities. So based upon the quality of the water, that is present of the salt, two types of organisms, urehaline and stenohaline. Going to the next abiotic factor. So the next abiotic factor here is going to be the light. You can ask me, how light? Light. What is the main source of light? It is the sun. Sun is not only the source of light but also heat. It is providing both light as well as heat. light is an important diverting factor because the plants that are there, these plants are producing their food by photosynthesis. Photo means light, synthesis is production. So light is required for the production of food. All the organisms are dependent on the plants for the food. So if plants are only not able to produce their food with light, then where from where we are going to get the food? So here, for the plants to produce the food, light is going to be, presence of light is going to be very much important. So light becomes a very important abiotic factor for the autotrophs. What are autotrophs? Autotrophs are going to be those organisms which are producing their own food using the light or other abiotic factors. So here we can see that plants are going to be producing their food by using the light, and we all are depending on the plants, and light becomes an important abiotic factor. Also, there are going to be some organisms or some plants who have adapted themselves to low light. For example, there are herbs and shrubs. What are herbs? Herbs are smaller plants, you can see. You can take your fenugreek, that is your methi, or you can take your coriander, that is your kothimbir. So all these are going to be the herbs. Shrubs, you can take your rose plant or the brinjal plant. These are known as the shrubs. Herbs and shrubs don't require direct light. They have adapted for photosynthesis even under the canopy. Canopy is nothing but a shaded area. Suppose you are going to the deep jungles. In the jungles, there are going to be large trees present. These large trees are having spreaded branches. So under these branches, there is going to be shade present. So under the shade also, the trees, that is the herbs and the shrubs, are coming in the low intensity of the light. So they have adapted themselves to survive under low intensity of light, that is under the canopy, but they require light. Then, sunlight is also required for photoperiodic responses like flowering. Many of the plants, almost all of the plants, are going to be depending on light for their blooming or for their flowering. You take any flower, usually are blooming in the day itself. Why? Because they are depending on the light. They are taking the responses from the light. The beautiful color of the flowers is going to be because of the light only, you can say, to some extent. So here we can see the sunlight is required for photoperiodic responses like flowering. Then, in animals, how light is playing an important role? One thing is, we are depending on the plants, so it becomes important anyways. But apart from that also, animals are using the diurnal and seasonal variations in the light. First understand this term, diurnal. Diurnal is nothing but the day-to-day changes or the daily changes what are happening. During the morning, the light is different. During afternoon, it is different. During evening, the light intensity is different. So based upon that, the diurnal, that is based upon the daily changes and seasonal variations. In summer season, the light intensity is different. During the rainy season, the light intensity is different. So based upon the daily changes in the light and the seasonal variation in the light intensity and photo period, that is the duration of the light that is available, the animals are using it as clues for timing their foraging. What is foraging? Foraging is nothing but search of food. For going out for food, for searching of the food, many animals are depending on the light. They take the intensity of the light as a clue. Okay, this is the time for us to go out. When the sun is going to be at this end, or when the light intensity is so much, I will get maximum food, so I can go out now. So based upon the light, the foraging activities are dependent. Not only the foraging activities, even the reproductive abilities. So all the organisms are not going to reproduce throughout the seasons or throughout the years. They are going to be reproducing only during a particular season when there is a particular light intensity present. Migration. What is migration? Migration is going to be nothing but moving from one place to another due to unfavorable conditions. For example, birds are migrating. from one place to another. So migration is taking place. This migration is also going to be depending upon the light. Usually if the light intensity becomes more, many of the organisms are moving towards the shaded areas. So that is going to be migration. So based upon the light intensity, they are, animals are using this light intensity for foraging, reproduction and migration. So this is how the light is going to be playing an important role as an abiotic factor. Now coming to the last one, that is going to be soil. So coming to the soil, soil is another abiotic factor which is going to be affecting the organisms. So how soil? Soil is nothing but weathered rock. We are having rock. When the weathering of the rock takes place or the dissolving of the rock takes place, the soil is formed. The plants, the trees require soil for their growth. They are growing in the soil itself. They are absorbing the minerals from the soil itself. So here, properties of soil are different, that is vary according to climate and weathering process. Based upon the type of climate, the type of soil is there, and based upon the weathering process, weathering is nothing but the dissolving of the rock or forming of the soil from the rock is known as weathering. So how the soil is formed? Based upon that also the properties of soil is going to be different. So based upon the climate and weathering process, the properties of the soil is different. Which properties? Soil composition. Soil composition is nothing but what the soil is made up of. Some soils are rich in minerals, whereas others are going to not have much of the minerals. Some soils are going to be having different type of making up, while the others are different. Soil composition. Grain size. Size of the each of the grain of the soil. You can take your sand, it is larger. You can take the black soil, the grain size is larger. Clay or the brown soil or the red soil is very soft to touch because the grain size is going to be smaller. So based upon the grain size and aggregation. Aggregation is nothing but the coming together or joining together. Suppose I am putting the water in the soil and trying to bind the soil. That is, suppose I take sand. Suppose I am putting water in the sand and I am trying to bind it. It will not bind. But suppose I put water in the clay or suppose I am putting the water in the red soil. It will bind easily or the particles will attach to each other. So that is aggregation. So based upon soil composition, grain size and aggregation, these are determining two properties of the soil. One is the percolation. Percolation is nothing but how much amount of water is going through the soil. Suppose I am taking a soil and pouring in the water, how much of water is coming down through the soil? In how much time? Percolation. And water holding capacity. How much of water remains in the soil? By now you know, in the soil, that is the sand, water holding capacity will be less. In the clay or in the red soil, the water holding capacity will be more. So that is a property of the soil. So based upon these properties, together with other properties like pH and mineral composition and topography. Topography is nothing but where the soil is present. Based upon that, we can see that topography is nothing but different type of place where it is present. Based upon that, the climate will be different, temperature will be different. So that is topography. So that will determine to a large extent the vegetation in any area. So which types of plant is present over there? Which type of crop is present over there? Is going to be based upon these factors. So what are they? The percolation, water holding capacity, pH of the soil and the mineral composition together with topography will tell you which type of plants can grow over there. Again, here, take your local example. When you are going to the Khanapur side or most of the Belgaum, you can say, is famous for basmati rice, or in total rice we are growing more of the rice in Belgaum. Suppose I am taking the same seeds and going towards the Bijapur side and try to grow the same quality of rice, it will not be possible. In the same manner, suppose I am trying to grow something like jawar over here, it is not coming as that quality like we are having there. Because there the soil is black soil, heat is there, it is required for that type of crop. So different type of plants are present in different type of areas based upon the soil characteristics. Cactus grows in the sand, whereas the larger trees are growing in the red soil or where the water holding capacity is more. So based upon that, the vegetation is going to be different. This soil is not only affecting the plants and animals on the ground, but it is also affecting the animals and plants that are present into the aquatic environment. The type of soil, the type of plant. The type of plant, the type of animal. It is specific, it is a chain. So here, plants are deciding the type of animals. In the same manner, even in the water, when we are talking about the sediment characteristics of the soil, means in the water bodies, when the sand or when the soil is settling down to the ground in the water bodies, based upon the soil properties, the type of the animals and plants are going to be decided. Depending upon the type of soil which is going to be present, benthic is going to be nothing but under the water, or the deeper layer of the water body is known as the benthic. So the type of the soil, that is the characteristic, sediment characteristics of the soil, is going to be deciding the benthic animals in the aquatic environment. So these are going to be some of the features which will tell us that soil is going to be an important abiotic factor. Now we know that there are four major abiotic factors which are affecting the life of the organism. Which are they? First is temperature, second is going to be your water, third is light, and fourth is going to be your soil. So temperature, water, light and soil are going to be the four important abiotic factors which are going to be affecting the life of the organism. These are the four abiotic factors affecting the life of the organisms. So about the next, we'll see my next one.